most recently, I graduated college, so did my boyfriend. We got engaged, we got married, we got 3 cats. We live in a house now. And yeah, I just have a lot more room to go into quiet areas. I have more space. must have abandoned her because Reaper herself did something to make her unworthy of the Wild Mother's love. So at the moment in the campaign, she has made it her task to earn the Wild Mother's love back. My drawing. done a lot of exploring. We helped. This version of your first fight is kobolds, because they're small and weak trope. We ended up befriending a kobold that took us back to his little family. They were all having a difficult time with a large bird-like creature that was kind of surrounded in inky darkness. And that was pretty terrifying. But in the end, it left the kobolds alone and ended up going towards the town that we had just left, that our gnome companion's family was from. So we went back, we started heading back, fought this creature, and there were actually some occultists attempting to aid it in finding our gnome friend. And during the fight, the gnome blacked out, and when he woke, he had a different personality and went by a different name. So we believe that he has been body swapped, which he always kind of seemed like a joke character. But now here we are, and he seems like he's gonna be the most important of all of us, which I absolutely love and greatly appreciate, because that's always the best. Like I said, I'm not like the most incredible artist in the world, and I also just, you know, am not positive that I know how to use Procreate very well, so I apologize to anyone who is really, you know, biting their nails, kicking their feet, screaming, you know, why are you doing this, drawing like this? Extreme when I watch videos, but I have a hard time watching people play some video games, just because any video game I've played, just because I react for ASMR. I can watch people play, you know, Minecraft and Stardew Valley and things like that, if I'm just watching it, like, just to enjoy it, no problem. But I can't watch anyone do it ASMR. I made. of crocheting at all. Only I just don't get, you know, the different kinds of stitches and things like that. So if I were to do any sort of crocheting video, I would have to be very clear that I don't know how to explain how to do my stitches. I make it up 100%. I just think, I look up pictures and I think, oh yeah, I like the way that pattern looks, and then I try to into how that would work 5 or 6 different ways, and then in the end, I just kind of go until I'm like, yeah, that looks pretty close, and then I just start using that kind of stitch. I don't know technical names for stitches, I don't know how to describe stitches, so maybe that wouldn't be very fun, because none of the things I do are really tutorials, because I'm just kind of making it up. I'm not kind of making it up, I am making it up as I go. So, I guess we'll have to see if that would be any fun. Maybe I'll record one or two and just see how it goes. But I think it would be fun. At the moment, I'm crocheting a poncho. Not at, you know, this moment while recording, but I'm crocheting a poncho. So I'm making one big circle that will have a neck hole for me. So I don't know if I'll start it over. I'm pretty far. It probably has 6 or so inch radius. So I've gotten pretty far in it. So I might just continue where from where it currently is. Or maybe I'll won't record it and start a new project. We'll have to see. Also don't crochet that often, so it's all up in the air. As far as the drawing goes, I still work a lot on perspective and how to get perspective right. So again, if you're a really good artist and these kind of things are painful for you, I fully and completely understand, and I don't blame you in the slightest for not being able to watch this without screaming at your phone. I do a lot of my things on Pinterest. I get a lot of my post references. You can see my laptop is folded in front of me. See the bottom little question mark on the Pinterest page. I have boards for almost all of my Dungeons and Dragons characters, named, each board named after them, and I have, you know, clothing and inspiration and character things, for all of my characters, air inspiration, weaponry, armor, if they wear armor, different things like that, what their magic looks like, and then, like, pose references, you know, not stick figure, I can never remember the name of what you call, like, the pose reference drawing situation, but there's a lot of those on my thing, just because, you know, it's a lot easier and I can have them up in front of me while I'm making drawings and things like that. So that's what's up on my laptop, if you're wondering. And then my laptop is connected to a monitor that I listen to videos and music through, on my headphones, which are connected. It looks like I lost focus a little bit on the camera, so that's fun. Because my camera is so high above my head. have to worry about those kinds of things, just so that I don't have to worry about running out of storage. So as long as the next video, this video will get uploaded, be on YouTube, I'll delete it from my phone, and then I'll upload another video to my phone. And as long as it's an hour and a half or shorter, then I'll be okay. So we'll figure that out in the future, and if I lose a video, I guess we'll cross that bridge when I get there. Like I said, I don't know how reliable I'll be about posting every week, maybe closer to every month, just because this is pretty time consuming. But right now, on my other channel, my Stardew Valley channel, I have videos, an hour long video every week scheduled out until October, just because it's a lot easier to record myself playing that and uploading it. So if you want to support me and I'm not posting videos here, and you like Stardew Valley, then those are a little bit better. Right now in the drawing, I am drawing chain mail, or more like scale mail, I suppose. This is just the technique I use. I think it looks, in my opinion, pretty good. It looks the way that I want it to look. I'm not great at drawing armor. I think Reaper may be the only character of mine that wears armor, honestly, just because the thought of drawing it is very stressful, because it has to look so solid, but it also has to look like the person is comfortable wearing it, and it's a lot more difficult than it seems. I would rather draw cloth and clothing and things like that. This drawing by the end doesn't have shading at the end, and I think I'd like to add that, but it is one of my favorite drawings that I've done so far, just because my favorite drawings are always the one that I feel like captures the attitude of the person that I'm drawing. And Reaper isn't really scary. She doesn't intend to be a scary individual. She is certainly intimidating, because I believe in her character description, she's certainly over 6 feet, close to 7 feet tall, and she's muscular and thin, you know, she's wearing armor, she carries a weapon. But those are all, you know, genetically. She has horns because she's a tiefling. That's just what she is. She's tall, but that's just what she is. She can't control any of those things. So those make her intimidating. And then she wears armor, and her weapon is a scythe. So, but her clothing isn't for intimidation. It's utility. She fights things. That's kind of her job, is to fight things. So all of those things make her intimidating. But I have made a drawing, and I intend on making drawings of all my characters in this format. But I have a drawing of her in her more off-duty clothes, and her off-duty clothes, she, you know, there's a lot, you know, she has a little bit of padding on for under her armor, but she wears like a, you know, a little bit of a dress over it, just because when it doesn't have utility, she would prefer to be more relaxed, and that's just her relaxed form. And I always like that, just to juxtapositioning characters. They're on duty and off duty, I suppose, quote, is in that mode where even when they're not wearing their armor, they're still going to be in something that they're ready to pick a fight in. Do they wear comfortable things? Do they wear pajamas? Do they walk around in their underpants? Do they, you know, what is their attitude when they're in it and they're ready to fight? And what's the attitude when they're not? Or are they ever in the attitude where they're ready to fight? Are they ever in the attitude when they're not ready to fight? Things like that. So, for Reaper, I already have an outfit made for her, and I would like to do that for all my other characters. I think that would be really fun. So hopefully in the future, I will make drawings of everyone, and you can see how they look too. I'm excited. As far as her armor goes, this summer for a Renaissance festival that my husband and I went to, I made my husband a EVA foam set of armor. I think it's Royal Guards armor. From Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom, I made him armor out of EVA foam, and just because I got so involved and so detailed with that armor, that's kind of what I ended up basing this armor off of, just because I ended up really learning the ins and outs of that armor and how armor works. I think that's another reason that I can become intimidated with armor, is because you kind of have to think about how it would all fit together, because it's not just, you know, these big chunks of metal on someone's body. They have to be able to move in it. It has to come on. They have to be able to take it on and off. You can't just, you know, make a chest plate that's just a tube of metal on their chest. It has to clip on and off. They have to have a way of getting in and out of it. Same thing with elbow pieces. You know, how does it stay on? Well, you would have to strap. You have to have metal straps of some kind. How are they protecting their hips? They would have to have some sort of plating on their hips. But they also need to sit down, so that plating can't just be affixed to their hips, you know, solidly. They have to be able to bend at the waist, things like that. So, I have no doubt in my mind that there are discrepancies, you know, like, I don't think I've ever drawn a way of how Reaper gets in and out of her chest piece, because another art piece, I believe, you can see, like, under her arms, and there's no clips or straps or anything that would come undone there, in almost any part of her armor. So, obviously, I didn't draw that in Reaper, you know, on Reaper's person, but, oh well. In the end, it's also about aesthetics. Much like everything, I'll say it again, I'm not an expert on these things, and I will never claim to be. You know, don't look at this and say, this is what I should model a real thing of armor off of, because that, good luck. But, in my mind, I think it looks good, and that's important. Things like that. Oh, in this part of the drawing, can see that I kind of made things pretty crooked, and it just got a little bit confusing, and, you know, things like that, things that just happen in art. But that's why I like digital art so much. You can go back a lot easier than it's certainly not easier to do digital art. You know, it's just a different thing altogether. It's pretty weird. But it's interesting. Like, I'll start drawing on paper again with pencil, and then all of a sudden I'm trying to hit the back button on the pencil mark I just made. It's like, you can't do that, or you want to layer things. That's definitely a big thing, is how much layers help in digital art. But then, of course, you start drawing on the same layer because you forgot to switch, and then it's all its own disaster. So, yeah, this chainmail, by the end I was pretty sick of it, and even watching it back, like, it just feels monotonous, and it kind of gave me, and I'm sure, I have no doubt that there are, like, amazing, incredible brushes that exist out there that people have nailed it down how to make chainmail like lickety split, and my brain just can't comprehend those. Even the few brushes that I've tried to use, I just get a little bit frustrated, and I don't know why, because they are better. They do look really nice and they do work really well. I just, for whatever reason, my brain just can't do it. So, maybe I'll make my own brushes at some point once I start to get a little more used to this and figure this out a little better. I can start making my own brushes, because then they can be in my style and I'll know how to use them. It'll just take a while to figure out, I think. Once again, like the Zelda armor that I made, I am working on the outer thigh protection pieces. For a lot of people, they struggle with hands and things like that, and I don't think that I'm great at hands, but the thing that I've always had a hard time getting is, like, leg proportions. I don't know why. But, like, the thigh to shin to foot proportions, I just never been able to understand how to get it. Even when I look at, you know, full body references and things like that, the second I put pen to paper, it, like, it all goes out the window, and I can look back and forth at it, and I just don't. It just never ends up looking right, and I really don't understand why. Or what it is that I just don't fully understand, but oh well. My cat Frey has her big belly up in the air, laying out in the sunshine on her couch. She's just the sweetest thing in the whole world. Maybe my ASMR whispering voices putting her to sleep. She loves laying in the sunshine, especially in the winter right now. Our house is heated by a pellet stove, which is just a big furnace that's in our living room that uses wood pellets. Wood pellets in order to heat the house, so it's the warmest in the living room, because of course that's where the heat is originating from, and then it gets pretty cold upstairs, and my husband works upstairs, and our bedroom's upstairs, and the cats, as much as they'd like to be warm, they also want to be with us. So they tend to be in our bedroom or be in the office with my husband, or in the bedroom when we're sleeping, things like that. But they end up getting because they like to sit in the front window and daydream about all the birds that they and squirrels that they could eat if they, you know, if I'd let them outside, which I do not. They're just adorable. Yeah, I ended up not liking the thigh pieces. The leg proportions felt off, so I adjusted them a little bit, and I do think it looks a little bit better. I think I ended up adjusting the left like thigh, I don't know what to call it other than like a thigh flap, which doesn't sound correct. I have no doubt that it is not correct, because it just looks a little bit off. Start thinking of more things to talk about during this video, just because this video is an hour and a half long. I am 50, I'm not even an hour in, and it's just hard. I don't really talk that much in my day-to-day life, so then to talk while recording is also difficult. I think that if I were able to, yep, I think I'm just like, checking to make sure it's recording. I'm definitely doing that. And then I'm going to erase the layer below, fully erase, and then I am going to begin coloring on the lower layer. I really like the way this line to say. I suppose I could start talking about Reaper. I really love Reaper's design. I always like to find, you know, you say like, oh, it's a tiefling. She's a paladin, so she'd wear armor. She's a tiefling, so she has horns. You know, things like that. And then I always like to think of something unique about them. It was kind of weird because my husband doesn't make a lot of personal characters, he makes a lot of NPCs, so, you know, it was kind of interesting to see him go through the character creator, because, of course, you know, he can just, he likes to be a little more plain about it, so, you know, yeah, you know, no tattoos, no piercings, regular colored hair, blah, 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 you know, all these things, natural colored hair, all of these things, and it was interesting because it was more like a visual representation of my process, the character creator for Baldur's Gate, because I was going through and I was like, yeah, hair colors, what kind of highlights do they have, if any, you know, do they have normal pupils, pupils like a snake, or one of my characters is a satyr, and she literally has pupils like a goat, she has like those like square pupils, and so it was just really interesting to ask myself, what kind of piercings do they have, if any, tattoos do they have, she's not expecting to be in combat, then she takes it down because, you know, she wears it up for utility, but she likes to wear her hair down. She likes to be more feminine on her off duty. So just things like that. I overcolored this section, so I end up erasing it later. But yeah, for all my characters, you know, how much skin would they prefer to show? How much makeup would they wear? What sort of facial, resting facial expression? Happy, sad, all of those things. And I think that came from, I think the beginning of that came from like Disney princesses and Disney characters and things like that. You know, their costume changes, the different dresses they would wear. I had like a Disney princess how to draw book, and that book quite literally had like, again, I don't know the name, but like all the character design, like, you know, Ariel, Princess Ariel with different facial expressions. You know, her angry, happy, sad. So I've drawn those from my own characters in the past. You know, all these different, like, mock-up ideas of how they make facial expressions. Ginny D, the YouTuber, does a lot of good, like, questions to ask about your characters. I've done that with my husband in the past. We were on a walk by your house, which is kind of out in the woods, and my question, you know, was like, when you're out, he asked me, like, when you're out walking, what do you like to think about? And I'm like, well, I think about in Dungeons and Dragons, what would my character be doing? Because anyone who's played D&D knows that a lot of it in the beginning, you know, before you have transportation or, you know, an airship or a boat or something, you're just doing a lot of walking from town to town. That's how you get around. So my thought is always, you know, how would, if Reaper were walking around right now, what would she be thinking about? You know, would she, or what would she be doing? What's her gait as she walks? Is she comfortable in her armor? How does she have her hair styled? Is she being extremely alert and watching where she's going? Is she annoyed? Is she, you know, are the other characters talking to her? Is she humming music? Is she humming songs? Is she, you know, paying attention to the birds, playing with her dog? Oh, this section of the drawing, her skin is very dark. It's almost like pitch black. And right now I'm using like a purpley color. I go through a few different like dark colors and it's kind of hard to see on camera, so I apologize. I end up adding highlights over the black line art. Yeah, I'm kind of tilting it so that I can see what I'm doing, so I apologize if, but this gets over pretty quickly. But I just like to think to myself, you know, what would she be talking about, if anything? Would she be singing, talking, dancing, walking, jogging? And why? And what would be going through her head? And if, depending on what she saw, what sort of different reactions to things would she have? Would she want to see different animals? Would she want to, you know, be playing with her puppy? Just different small things like that, which I think can make a character, because if you think about those things now, then when you get to your next session and you're playing with other players, you don't have time to process through, not sit down, walk around and process through that and kind of be living it, you know, what would she be thinking, you know? I already thought about that. So, things like that, I just really love and appreciate. You know, in the car, I think about if this were Reaper riding around in a carriage, you know, she's moving, but so she's paying attention, but her hands are free. And Reaper has always just been more of a quiet character. She prefers to observe, but she loves animals, and as much as she gets shy about talking to people, she's observing the people around her, making sure that they're safe. Her companions ask her questions, and she answers, because, you know, why wouldn't she? She likes her companions. So far, they've proven themselves to be kind people who have similar values to herself, so she's not going to initiate questions, but when her eldritch friend asks, you know, why are you here? Why do you want to help people? You seem, you know, last session she asked, you seem rather intimidating, rather intense, but obviously you are helping individuals. You seem to like doing that, and that seems a little suspicious to me. Why would you do that? And she answered, you know, I left my home and in an unfair way, and I don't think other people should have to feel like that, so that's why, you know, I can't go home, so I might as well help other people go home, because that's what's right. And just different like that. And it was honestly, I play in some games where people don't want to roleplay as much as they just want to fight, and that's obviously fun too. But it was really fun to have another player at the table who is as invested as I am in the roleplay element of it. I really love the roleplay elements of Dungeons and Dragons. It's easily my favorite part. Solving problems. I definitely love the fighting. I think that's fun too, but solving problems in a more creative way, or diplomatic way, or intimidating way. Having conversations and things like that as other characters, I think, is what makes D&D fun. You know, you don't, most people don't play Dungeons and Dragons playing a character, you know, playing themselves. They want to explore elements of themselves. I think every character that someone plays is a part of them. You know, if you're making a funny character, you know, you're gonna play them as what you find funny. That's, you know, a view into who you are as a person and what you find to be entertaining. If you're playing a funny character who makes fart jokes all the time, that's because you find fart jokes funny. You're not gonna make a funny character and make jokes that you yourself don't find funny. That just wouldn't really make any sense. So all of those are elements of a person. You know, if you want to make a character who's beautiful and a little self-centered, that doesn't mean that you see yourself to be a gorgeous individual who's very self-centered, but maybe you're the exact opposite and you want to explore what it would be like to be in that headspace where you view yourself as so, you know, incredibly beautiful that you kind of become more self-absorbed in what that would be like, and finding, you know, and that person goes from being more self-absorbed, and realizing that she doesn't want to be anymore, or they don't want to be anymore, and in realizing that they don't want to be that person anymore, they want to find the balance where they love themselves, but they also love other people. You know, you as an individual maybe doesn't love yourself that much, also with them. loving yourself a little more so that there's that balance between loving others and yourself equally. That's an example. In my, you know, character idea of Reaper, Reaper doesn't feel that she is worthy of the Wild Mother's love anymore, and exploring, you know, that relationship of, you know, feeling that she needs to earn love. And obviously, I just explained that these things are a window into a person's life, but not that I feel that way, but, you know, all of these difficult topics to explore can be explored in a more, in a healthier way, whether you feel them currently or not, or whether, oh yeah, I'm checking whether or not it's recording. I believe I stopped the recording for a few moments. Whether or not you have felt those things, or might feel them in the future, or just want to explore that topic for other people or with other people, that's kind of what it is. Our Under Armor sections, it's kind of hard to tell, but that is the purple area that I ended up moving away from for skin. I made it a darker red, a darker tone with a red undertone, and this is the padding of her armor with that dark purple undertone. It's a little hard to tell on camera, but I just wanted to explain that quickly. Another group that I watch a lot, well, firstly with Critical Role, I think Liam O'Brien, all of his three characters kind of go along with, you know, grief and how to kind of get through that. If you think it's your fault, if you've lost a family member, things like that. Dimension 20, Allie Beardsley, they themselves, you know, all their characters tend to be exploring, you know, institutional problems with religion, or I mean, Brennan is always having the idea and the exploration of the, you know, the negative sides of capitalism. So I just think those are always very interesting, and I think the DM brings those things in as well, you know, things that they feel are issues that need to be explored for the characters. But I just always find those interesting, and I don't take them literally, you know, when another player at the table says, you know, reveals that their conflict is that they, you know, hurt someone in the past, and they're, you know, exploring that as an element of drama, is obviously not a thought in the back of my mind that they literally, as a human being in real life, did those things, but, you know, just different elements like that. So I just think that's fun, when a person comes up with a character, exploring, what that means for the person playing them. Equate to the real world, as long as it's all in-game and not something you're saying, as a person at the table to other characters, but, when you are playing this game and doing all of these different things to, you know, explore those things, I wrote a paper in college about, you know, how Dungeons and Dragons can be used in therapeutic settings for adults and for children, and exploring things in a more separated way, you know, as a Dungeons and Dragons character, but there's still a attention to things like that pop, which I love. Getting closer to the end here. I like to add another thing about my drawings is that I like to think about colors and a color scheme. For people, you know, what kinds of things would look good on them if they would care about, you know, choosing colors and things that would look good on them, color schemes. I always have to be careful because I personally love the color green. My favorite color is purple. But I always, always love, like, the aesthetic that the color green gives to things. My living room is painted green. It's just such a beautiful color. But I always have to tell myself, like, would this person actually look good in green? Or is that just because you love the color green? And especially with Reaper, because of her red hair. As much as I wanted to do, like, a green padding underneath her armor and things like that, it was like, do you want her to look like she's the embodiment of Christmas? And so I ended up moving away from green, even though I love green. I have another character named Elise, who her armor is black and green and gold, and her armor is just so gorgeous. And she's gorgeous. I told that also to my husband. I was like, I want all my characters to be beautiful. And he said, that's probably, he's like, if you're sensing a theme, then you should try to move away from that theme. And I'm like, as much as I agree that it's good to get out of your comfort zone, no. They're not all conventionally attractive, I wouldn't say that, but, you know, I want to draw someone who's, like, who's visually appealing, somebody visually interesting that I would enjoy drawing, you know, even if they're not attractive in, like, a conventional sense. I want them to be visually appealing. I don't want them to be boring looking. That's more, you know, if someone has, you know, something physical about them that people would, might be like, oh, that is, like, checks the boxes of what would constitute ugly, which is just ridiculous anyway. But I just don't want someone to be plain. I think my plainest character, I do have a pretty plain character, but he was one of the first player characters I made, and the point of him was kind of to be that plain looking nobody guy who had a lot more darkness and was kind of hiding it behind a facade. And I would say that he's probably visually one of my plainest characters because he's a human cleric. He's a blonde man, you know, who doesn't have that much interesting stuff going on, but that's just because, you know, his backstory is a lot darker and he kind of prefers to be that more frugal. He kind of prefers to live a more frugal, quote, boring life, because his life before that was a lot more intense. I'm gonna have to go through and think of who I can draw next. I've drawn, I think, at least one drawing of all my characters. So again, maybe a time lapse from my iPad slowed down a little bit could be interesting. I'll have to see. lighter armor color. I think I like Reaper's armor to be a little bit darker metal, but I wanted it to look a lot nicer on camera, so I made it a little bit lighter. I chose this lighter option so that it just looked a lot better for the viewer. I'll have to see in the future how I can work around that, or maybe just draw lighter or keep it. We'll have to see. Future video plans, like I said, I don't know that I will be able to upload, you know, every single week, but I think I'd like to just challenge myself to do once a month. I think is safe, because once a month sounds pretty accomplishable, and if I go more than once a month, then that'll feel really amazing, and it'll probably fluctuate as I get busier. But like I said, if you're interested in more frequent uploads from me, then my other channel will be great. And I linked it in my most recent community post yesterday, I believe. I don't know if it's yesterday as of recording this audio. I don't know about yesterday as of when this video will be posted. I post on that channel every Tuesday, so I'm thinking maybe this channel every Thursday would be pretty, not every Thursday, but on Thursdays would be nice. Maybe the first Thursday of every month could be fun. Just because jewelry. It's one of my favorite things about her, and I think it makes it stand out a lot, so I really, really love it, because it was one of the first things I came up with for her character, and I just think it looks beautiful. I think it looks good on her. I think it makes her more dynamic and recognizable. You know, if I were to draw a tiefling with those specific piercings, then you'd kind of know her even without me. I think it's cool when characters have a color element, you know, like those challenges where it's just a few lines of color like on a square, and then you have to guess, you know, what person is this. I think there was a trend on TikTok for a while, and just after a few seconds, you know, there are those characters iconic enough that you're like, oh, that's, you know, Buzz Lightyear from Toy Story, because of the way, you know, the different colored stripes, but they're just that iconic. I think that's important, but also, you know, without coloring someone in, who are they just because of those obvious visual cues? I haven't really done the silhouette test on any of my characters. I think assigned to do it. She also has so much on her plate, though. She's doing so many amazing things, like, constantly. So, if she can't, that's fine, too. But, if she wants to, you have one subscriber. Fan arts of, you know, Critical Role things. I'm not really sure. Or Dimension 20 or other groups. I'm not sure yet if GB makes her ASMR Dungeons and Dragons channel. I'll make fan art of that. Possible crocheting or knitting in the future. I have been working on writing a lot of things, so probably not showing my writing, but maybe some typing, things like that. I want to explain the last bit of this before the video ends. On Reaper's scythe, after she left her home, she took her scythe through the woods and found a suit of armor with a skeleton inside of it, and to her that was her sign that the Wild Mother had given up on her, because the only thing that she could find in her time of need was a thing of decay. But her scythe had, I'm about to draw it, golden lettering along the side. What it said, and I cannot remember. Right now it's just gibberish. But it said, you know, something about the Wild Mother. That's so embarrassing, I apologize. So I'm writing in here in gold. That was originally written on the scythe, and once she believes the Wild Mother has given up on her, and that she is no longer worthy of the Wild Mother, not she doesn't believe in her anymore, but that she feels that she was abandoned for good reason. She scratches it out. So I'm just using some gray to kind of give it that more worn away effect. And I do one direction and then the other. And that's when the video ends. The video. Hopefully this was relaxing and you have fallen asleep or eased your anxiety. Maybe this inspired you to draw alongside me or